Rochester Common Council meeting, March 22nd, 2016. And as usual, we'll start with our Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, welcome, everyone. We're going to start tonight with, we've still got our public hearing on the Downtown Revitalization Study Resolution. And actually, we're kind of working in a reverse order here. We had the public hearing with the Okra folks, but it was misadvertised, so we have to talk about it this evening and act on the resolution for the approval of the downtown study. And are there any comments relative to the subject, the revitalization study? Terry?
I would say that since the city council meeting on the 22nd, I think, of February, we had a meeting last week of business and property owners in downtown. We met at Giretti's. There was probably 35 of us in attendance. We had a lot of feedback on the plan, I think. Most of it was kind of like, okay, let's go, get going. The things that stood out to me in that conversation was don't make any drastic changes to the courthouse. I think the plan right now shows something planned on every corner of the courthouse square. I think some of the feedback we got was if you do something there, do it respectfully, do it thoughtfully, be careful of permanent structures, those kind of things, improve the area for the use of the community. But maybe not to the extent of the plan that had been sort of submitted by, you know, those guys that sit around and draw plans up. And then I think the other feedback we got pretty loud and clear was the 9th and Main lot across from Walgreens was moved forward with the plan for that as a green space and maybe a performing arts space, a programmable space, a public space that might host a couple of events there. So I think other than that, I don't know if there's any other public here. It seems like we've had some meetings that weren't announced and so forth. We've had a lot of public feedback on it. So it's still a working document. There's still some corrections, revisions that I think it needs. There's some pieces of it that are repetitive. They restate things kind of. We could really trim it down to more of a working plan, I think, with some more work. I know I've heard from the Downtown Partnership folks already that they want to get printed copies of it so they can really kind of get into it and crunch it. But it will be revised as we go along. So the feedback that I got that I wanted to report on was the courthouse and the 9th and Main. So
one quick question, 9th and Main. Have you had any updates from either Mr. Lau or Mr. McIntyre relative to the wall situation?
I have not, Mayor. I have been working on getting fill in there and getting utilities stubbed up and getting our side of the property line ready for them, which I think should, we took the fence down today. We've got the utilities stubbed up yesterday. We should have fill in it by the end of the week or first of next week, depending on. Brian Lewis also is talking to helping me with that, so I think he's contacted Mr. McIntyre. The last conversation I had was we'll be there April the 1st, so we'll see. But I can't, you know, that's I'm not guaranteeing that. I'm not even necessarily predicting that, but that's the plan as we've gone into the project. So
okay, thank you. Anybody else? Thanks, Terry. Okay, are there any other questions or comments relative to the revitalization study? Yes, Senator Peterson?
If I may just make a comment, I went to the meeting at Giretti's, and there were some others there who felt as I did that the extensive development of the courthouse lawn was not necessarily appropriate for that structure. But the courthouse, a beautiful structure, requires a large yard, and it's beautiful as it is. I won't say anymore. There were some others who felt the same way.
Falls into some historical parameters too there that involve that space. Understand. Appreciate the comment.
I think the 9th and Main development is very good.
Thank you. Okay, anybody else? Anything to add or question? That being the case, before closing the public hearing, we can actually act on resolution 3-2016 on this subject. Could we have the first reading of resolution 3-2016, Mr. Goodman?
I'll make a motion that we read resolution 03-2016.
Do we have a second?
Is that in its entirety or?
Entirety.
I second.
Those in favor? 5-0.
Okay, resolution 03-2016, local resolution approving the Rochester Downtown Revitalization Study, PL-14-016. Whereas the City of Rochester, Indiana had identified adequate reason to analyze the Rochester Downtown Revitalization Study dated February 2016, and whereas the City of Rochester has hired Strategic Development Group to define and describe the issues, advise us of our options, and make recommendations to address this issue in the near future, and whereas the City of Rochester has received federal community development block grant dollars from the Indiana Office of Community and Rural Affairs to fund this plan and has contributed $4,500 as local match for this project, and whereas the City of Rochester has reviewed the process and completed study thoroughly and is satisfied with the services performed, information contained therein, and methodology applied, whereas the City of Rochester has received
excuse me, we've got the electronic version, but I think because of the modifications, I don't know that we've received the official printed one. I have four copies in my office. So if we go by hard copy, is that what they're asking for, Terry?
Yes. Four copies of this document for our records, and we'll keep them on file at the City Hall and one copy at the Public Library for future reference. And be it resolved by the City of Rochester that the final document is hereby approved, contingent upon comments and approval received from the Indiana Office of Community and Rural Affairs. The City of Rochester will fully consider all comments and feedback received from the Indiana Office of Community and Rural Affairs and will direct its consultant to provide amended copies of this plan reflecting all said comments.
Okay.
Move to suspend the rules and read for the second time.
It's a resolution. We only need to read it once.
Oh, it is a resolution. That's right.
So make a motion for the adoption of resolution 03-2016.
Those in favor?
Second.
Or sorry, second. John second. Those in favor? Okay, 5-0. Okay, resolution 3-2016 passed. Okay, do I have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Those in favor? Okay, public hearing is now closed. Moving on into the City Council meeting, minutes for the Council meeting of February the 23rd, 2016. Do I have any corrections or additions to the minutes? A motion to accept the minutes.
So moved.
Second. Second by Brian. Those in favor? 5-0. And the Board of Public Works and Safety minutes were for information only. Okay. Communications. Larry Hoover, the EMA director, is here this evening with a topic of interest.
I hope so.
Okay. And I might ask, too, anybody who has any comments or anything to report, please give your name for the record before you make any statement. The Sentinel greatly appreciates that, don't you, Wes?
I do.
Okay, Larry, I'm sorry.
You're fine. You're fine. Good evening. Like the mayor said, I'm the new EMA director for Fulton County, and just coming to talk to you about a few different items of concern. One of them is the NIMS program, which is the National Incident Management System. I'd like to encourage you guys to look into that, do a little training on that. They have a few very basic classes to teach you the process. And as Tom can probably confirm, that is how we handle disasters, or even like the fire we had Saturday. It's a process, it's been established. The problem with it, not really the problem with it, the problem with lack of knowledge on your part is if you sign paperwork, for example, we responded to Hurricane Sandy. We were out in Nassau County, New York. The mayor signed over basically complete control to a group of people from Indiana. We had autonomy to do whatever we wanted there. That's not something you really want to do. We were there to help in the disaster, not to take over the disaster. So that's something I would really encourage you guys to look at. It doesn't take long to go through a couple of classes. If you have any questions, I'm right here on the edge of town, so I'd be more than happy to answer.
Larry, what's the possibility of some NIMS training locally that the group could participate in? Is that a possibility?
It's a possibility. The 700, the 100, and the 200 are just simple online courses. Maybe take you 30 minutes per class. Shada, you've taken them, right?
I just haven't taken my test.
Right.
They're not very long, 15, 20 minutes. And I will add to what Larry said, because we just went through this with our Arctic blast a couple of years ago, that had I not had the NIMS training, we would not have gotten the federal funding or the reimbursement funding from FEMA that we did for that particular incident. If y'all recall, it was the first part of January. We had a water main break. We had craziness going on. And one of the things about this is if we don't follow the management system to the T, we potentially will lose funding from any kind of reimbursement that we would have. And then some disasters can be very costly. If we have a tornado go through, if we have any other kind of natural disasters, from the financial standpoint, because you're the fiscal body, you need to understand the process that you have in that, or the role that you play in that, because the actual management of the disaster will fall to our emergencies services personnel, but the finance part of it will fall to us.
Do you have
to sum that up well?
And ultimately, we'll be looking to you guys for the decisions.
Yes.
On where we're going, who's finance, the financial side of things.
Do you have the email or the link to follow to?
Yes, we can get that to you.
Could you send it to all of us?
And you said that was 700, 300?
700, 100, and 200. It's the federal government. They don't number anything with any kind of sense. So.
No sense. Huh?
No.
Scratch that, Scott.
No, he can put that in there. I don't care. In fact, actually, I encourage Shada, when was it, January, Shada, when you took that finance section class?
Mm-hmm.
Encourage Shada to take some training that was more geared for her on some of the documentation you need. It's very detailed and very time-consuming, but it's 10 times harder to go back afterwards and try to put all that back into place. So that was the main point for me coming tonight. I did have one more question for you. I know when Dave was here, whenever we did declare, last month,
mm-hmm.
because of that wet, heavy snow, you guys are exempted. You guys exempted from yourselves from county declarations under the old regime. That was my understanding from Dave. So that if the county declares that the roads are closed, the city of Rochester is still exempt and continues on.
Correct.
Is that something you guys want to continue? That's entirely up to you, but just for my knowledge going forward.
Personally, I believe that's the way to do it. I mean, there are many times when the county roads will be closed and the Rochester city situation, we're open. And you got people living in the city who can get to places of work and such. So be it. We'll do that.
Okay.
But if it gets to the point where it is a horrific situation, then we'll work together on that and participate accordingly. But I know many of the businesses and industries stay open.
We had a question about that. I was talking to Larry about that yesterday because we had to, we were attempting to figure out with both Terry and I looking
could,
at the office.
Could you identify yourself?
Amy Rowe, Fulton County Chamber of Commerce. Thank
okay.
You. Allowing you to speak. But we were looking at that with the two organizations that we are technically county, and we were talking about, well, it came up because the employee that works at the chamber is in the county. She has to come from Talma. And so when I was making decisions for the organization for the Fulton County Chamber of Commerce, of course, I said Fulton County Chamber of Commerce would follow the Fulton County designation. But I didn't know that there were different designations related to that. So the conversation that we looked at is someone going to receive a fine if they are coming into work in Rochester, if they have to go through the county? That was kind of the question for me with Kelly and some other folks that were driving in. We have 4,000, according to the statistics, Region 2 has 4,000 folks coming in to work outside of the county into Fulton County to work. So I guess those are some of the questions.
Well, the issue, correct me if I'm wrong, Larry, but we discovered this last year. The issue gets even stickier than county and city. If the county calls a disaster and says they're going to ticket people on the county county roads, that doesn't include the state highways.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. Your county people can't ticket people on the state highways. Mm-hmm. So it gets even more convoluted.
Yeah, and that's where we were just, you know, I had asked him yesterday just for us to be able to put a policy together for the chamber and for, you know, Terry. FEDCO for all of us to do that, to have it for our office so folks know what's going on. But then there's the other piece of that situation there. But that was some of what our thought was. For me, for Kelly, who works in the, or who lives in the county working in the city, that was a hard line in the sand figuring out how to draw that and understand.
And Terry, correct me if I'm wrong, you have any information on this, but we do have, in the industrial sectors out here, we do have people who are sending people home or closing their plants when the county does call it a disaster situation. And we got people who are not. They're leaving things open. So we have a mixed bag there. Is that the way you're seeing it too?
Yeah, we do have a bit of a mixed bag, I think. And I think most employers are, if the county's closing down roadways, then I think that's considered, you know, an excused absence at most corporations. But it's all case by case and internal decisions. You know, they don't want individuals putting themselves at risk, and they don't want emergency management individuals having to deal with all the slide-offs. So if the county roads are announced as closed, then, you know, you're still going to have maybe small businesses, like, you know, I live two blocks from my office, so I'm going to be there. My staff lives very close, so we're going to be there. That's our internal decision. But we're on city streets by and large. So, you know, I don't think there's any clear-cut answer to it, except if the county's closed, it's an emergency situation. There shouldn't be travel on county roads. And so businesses are juggling that a little bit. But yeah, to come to the understanding that the city is a different jurisdiction, and state highways is a different jurisdiction, cleared some of it up for some of the larger employers. But I think it's just really all about communication. Think about companies that are working three shifts that have to communicate to three different shifts of workers, and they're making the best decision they can based on the information available to them at that time. So,
because it was passed related to Rochester metal products, correct? I think that's why they had originally looked into that. I think Shada had stated that, is that some of the manufacturing facilities inside of city limits were being prohibited from doing business, and it wasn't helpful for them.
Right.
Because they have a mix. Again, you have folks coming in from the county, you have folks that live in the city, and if you happen to be on one of those roads that they've plowed and, you know, 5 seconds later it's closed again, or that wet, heavy snow, it's just a bucket of ice, and you're not getting through it. You know, I know the plows had a lot of trouble getting through some of that stuff. So it's a challenge for the large employers.
For HR purposes, too, because I know one of the companies, she was stating, because she lives in the county, she's not allowed to come in, but yet she's being punished by having to take, I think, a vacation day,
or personal
even
day.
Though it's not, she can't control the weather. So there was some conversation related to that. I don't know the solution at all, but.
Yeah, I think it's Terry hit it on the head. We'll just have to have good communications as to what's happening and.
I think one of the things that really that helped too was when the county officials communicated that they weren't going to pull people over and ticket them for traveling on a county road, but if there was a slide-off situation and they had to bring resources to that, a slide-off or what have you, then there might be a ticket issue. But some people, employees, were saying, well, I'm not coming in because I'm going to get a ticket if I'm on the county roads. And the county officials communicated that they weren't going to pull people over for tickets, and you can check with those guys to make sure that's still their protocol. But you know, if issues were caused by that, then somebody could be ticketed for being out. So.
Well, and the sheriff addressed that last night. He, you know, his stance is if you're trying to get back and forth to work, that's one thing. But if you're out,
joy, right?
We've all been that age where, I got the new truck and we're going to see what can do. And yeah, because all that does is clog up the highway or the county roads, and then the county highways slow down, either pulling out people or going around people. Those are the ones that are generally going to get a ticket. So,
right.
And generally, we're talking when we're closing roads countywide like this, it's going to be a snowstorm
or an ice storm. Yeah.
A tornado or something like that's going to be totally something totally different that hopefully it never happens. But if it does, we will be working together because that's just going to be a totally different ballgame.
Well, and part of that scenario, too, isn't just for the snowplow convenience. Somebody slides off and nobody can get out and get to them.
Correct.
It's pretty dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the resources that are tied up for that.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
That's all I had, gentlemen. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we have...
I had a communication as well.
Okay.
Believe it or not, it's about 9th and Main, but something other than the hole in the ground. It's the traffic lane markings on Main Street that are gone. And the turn lane that's on Main... to go left, is the white stripes are pretty much gone, so that people don't pull up far enough to trigger the turn signal.
Mm-hmm. I've noticed that multiple times.
Yeah, and I don't know if that's city responsibility because it's Main Street there, or whether it's state because it's an intersection of two state roads.
I mean, the center lines were just painted. Who painted those?
You're talking about on the south
side
of the light? That's state highway.
No, on the north side of the light.
Yeah, that would be ours.
Okay. On the north side of the light.
On the north side.
This side,
That would be ours.
That would be us.
And then 9th Street would be ours.
Well, that's what I said. Someone just painted the center lines. They just didn't paint. They painted the yellow.
No, we
didn't
change the light.
To the side street.
Well, we don't change bulbs out there or anything.
No, they're talking about the striping.
Oh, the striping?
On the street. But didn't we just stripe that street? Or did we just do the center line?
We just did center line.
Okay, so we need to go back and have them give us a quote on doing the actual turn lines.
There's kind of like a box in Main Street that's a back away, and I think people kind of think that's where the trigger is because they stop there.
Yeah, they need to go forward.
The trigger is quite a ways in front of those.
Stop bars are going too, aren't they?
Yeah.
The stop bars?
You want to make a note of that, Warren, and we'll check that out.
Okay,
thank you. Good communication. We actually have one other person here under communications that we've written in. Sorry, Marty, you went out of order.
I'm sorry, I apologize in advance to whoever else it is.
He was always pushy in school.
Careful.
We have Amy Rowe here tonight with the chamber.
Yes.
And,
she is the subject of fireworks, right?
Yes. And thank you to Shada for letting me know that I needed to speak. I knew if I asked enough folks that I'd figure out who to speak to about it. So we are partnering with the American Legion for the fireworks. Thank you, Mayor Denton, for coming on that conversation. That will help us to be able to be free to do other things. But I am actually partnering with Gene Manners, and we are doing it together this year so that we can make sure that it's successful. That said, we had a joint conversation.
Gene
Manners. Gene that was at the meeting.
Sanders.
That was Manners. M-A. Sanders?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
His email is M-A-N-E-R-S. But
is it? I believe that.
Okay. So we'll change Sanders. So we sat down with RKM, which is the fireworks company, and they had stated that July the 3rd, which is a Sunday, is a day that's a little bit better for them than the 4th. In addition, we had called and checked with Akron to see what day they were doing their event, and their full event's on the 4th. So we were looking at July the 3rd for the fireworks this year, and wanted to make sure that that works for everybody before we move forward with signing the contract with RKM.
That doesn't pose any problems for us, does it, Tom?
As far as staffing wise and all of that, I didn't know.
Well, do you require some help with parking? And
this is my first journey with this,
I see.
I believe from the paperwork there was a sheriff's reserve.
Sheriff's reserves normally are out there patrolling. We normally go out because people start gathering early. So we normally have the firemen out there because once the event starts, if there is an incident, we're not going to get out to the station. But we've had a couple guys bring in a couple four-wheelers. We've used the EMA's gator because we have undoubtedly people lighting fireworks
on the side
in the assembly area, and that's not safe. We do try to kind of patrol them. The street department normally brings out barrels on Friday, the day of the event. The fire department normally makes sure that they're still set up from Friday beforehand. Like I said, we kind of assist with some of that. We've had some minor medical incidents out there we were able to take care of right away. And afterwards, we try to help with some of the traffic flow to make sure that they're not cutting through. We kind of help secure the airport area as well.
Okay. So Sunday would not be a day that would be impossible to manage.
No, and like okay. I said, with Akron's always being in the 4th, I mean, I think there's always been a flux with the city of Rochester, so people can enjoy both events.
Yeah, we want to be respectful. I had spoken to Tiffany Adams.
Because that is their town's anniversary.
Yes, so and they're...
It's a big deal over there.
Very proud of that event.
The only thing, whoever you're going to have contracted to shoot your fireworks, make sure they file for the state permits, they have proof of the insurance, and that's to me well before the event so I can sign it and get it back in their hands, because the permit's not valid until it's signed by the chief. You need to see their design plans and where they're shooting from, normally the same as always, it's really not an issue. And
We've already spoken about the insurance that's covered. I actually went and spoke to Megan at Smith, Sawyer & Smith. There was a question because we had two insurance policies, one from y'all and one from RKM, so I've gotten that cleared up. And as far as the permits, that is on RKM, that's Brian. So once we get the contract signed, then I have all that information I can bring to you, or even before we sign it.
Y'all raised me?
Yeah, so you're the man. And I...
That's exactly, Chief, that's exactly why I had to go to the American Legion with her, so they could understand.
Y'all, and I did reach... I did reach out to Ted Cox, as you suggested.
Okay.
So he
for the airport mm-hmm. board.
Yeah, so I called him today, and I'm going to hear hopefully back from him tomorrow.
That would be a good move. That's mm-hmm. very very good.
So.
Do you need a proof of insurability from your fireworks people? You've got all that.
We've got the liability insurance.
Okay.
Yep, they will. They've already sent that to me, and then we have Smith, Sawyer, and Smith. If one's not enough, we've got two.
Good.
So, do we need anything else, Shada, from the?
I don't believe so. Other than, like I said, the permit that Tom's talking about, your van
and camera. And that is part. That's part of the
State
price.
Department of Homeland Security.
Yeah. And I believe that's part of the contract pricing.
Should be. That's who normally comes because it's permits in their name.
Okay.
And then there's an underwriter would be the city or the Chamber of Commerce or this year might be the Chamber of Commerce and the Legion, and then the insurers would have all that as well for the event.
Cool.
I think
we're set. Sold.
Thank you for allowing me to.
Check. Moving on.
Thank you
so much.
Okay, reports of officers. Chief Butler. demonstration time.
Give a copy of last month's report to everyone. I'll go through it quickly, and then I have a little demonstration to show you with the new equipment that the city has already purchased and what we have in order. For February, structure fires, we had one in the city. Equipment fires, we had one in Rochester Township. It was a compactor. Calls for smoke, one in Rochester Township. Auto fire alarms, two in the city, one in Rochester Township. Unauthorized burning, one in the city. It wasn't the Rose. Mutual aid, we had one in Henry Township. That was a grass fire, one in Liberty Township, and one in Mentone. Accidents, we had five in Rochester Township, one in Richland Township. Gas leaks, one in the city. Medical assist, we had 15 in the city, four in Rochester Township, one in Richland Township. And we drove the ambulance one time for a total of 37 calls and one drill. Our drill was on water rescue techniques, and we utilized the middle school pool. Two things to demonstrate. First things we did, one of the mutual aid fires was up in Mentone, and we did have a firefighter fall through the floor, which created a communication problem. Okay, this is my work clothes. It's my business suit when I go to work. You guys having a hard time hearing me. If I'm trapped in the basement, if I'm screaming, help me, I can't hear. With this device that we just purchased at $350 a piece, can you now hear me adequately? And there's no back interference when I'm using my radio. So I can talk clearly, it's gonna give me calm peace of mind, and I can call out for help and hopefully be heard. So I said, this is the new device that we have on order. They're a total of $350, which seems a lot, but if you're in a dark basement trapped, that little device is gonna make the difference in getting out. That was one of the problems where the firemen fell in. TJ luckily was right there with them, never left them, but communication, are you hurt? We couldn't hear, he was in the basement, we're still on the first floor. So we're gonna purchase 15 of these. I'm gonna have five in my main engine, five in my rescue truck, and then five in our backup engine. And then I'm gonna assign masks personally, and everyone will have the $29 adapter on their mask. So fireman will have his own personal mask. He gets in the truck, if he's in his seat with the air pack, he'll grab the device, click it in his mask, he's ready to go to work.
What was at the mask prior to the $29?
Just the filter on the other side. It's just, okay, just a quick adapter, so it's still
so it replaces a filter.
It's still over.
Oh, okay.
It's just in the nose cup, and it actually helps keep the mask clear when we're breathing.
So good job, Tom. I think that's a great idea.
It just clips on. And then one of the things we did learn and were able to purchase and received right away was our rapid intervention pack.
Tom, if I could interrupt before
sure.
you move from the amplifier. I had some questions when it hit the paper after the Board of Works meeting that we were purchasing these for $350 a clip. We could have bought 40 of these to cover the whole department. And Tom, in his assessment and wisdom, noted that very rarely do we have a fire where we're going to have more than 15 firemen actually inside where these types of items will be necessary. So they're going to be carried on the fire engine, isn't that correct?
Correct. It'll be on.
Everybody has the adapter, but
correct.
They're on the fire engine, so the 15 that are going to be there will be able to get them. And even folks from other departments might be able to utilize them also. Is that
true? Only some of the other departments have different masks, so that might not work unless we're actually to exchange the masks. You have to have the clip. But the thing is, when I come out and I'm tired, I'm using my air pack, I'm getting it swapped out. You've seen how easy it was for me to, okay, you're next, and he's going in. He still has the same safety device. So once they're on scene, we normally have, you know, of course, the engine would be on scene in the rescue, and if it's that big of an incident, our backup engine would respond. So we should technically have all 15 on the scene. Like I said, and I can use my radio. The earlier version of these, when these came out, we had these years ago. There was so much back fee when you tried using a radio, electronic to electronic. It didn't work right. This is a non-issue. It works very well.
Well, I make a point of this because a lot of times the chief will get flack about, gee, the fire department's buying something all the time. He looks at these things very academically, very prudent. We could add a request for 40. We did not, and this is going to work very satisfactorily for him.
I think
appreciate
so.
It, Chief.
Thank you.
Chief, what is the range on that? I mean, is it just something I'd be able to hear you in the same room, or would you be able to hear it out at the
truck?
Well,
just like you. No, I won't be able to hear it in the truck. I'd have to be on the radio. I mean, if I screamed or yelled, you might hear it, but then I think it's going to get a little distorted. But just like we're talking now, when I had that on,
okay,
and sealed, you heard my breathing, you heard that regulator popping more than you heard my voice until I activated the device. So that's the key factor there.
But Saturday, the conditions that our folks were working in, visibility was zero.
And that was external. Internal attacks are like that all the time. That's why you see the firemen so many times getting on the roof and cutting a ventilation hole, because we want all that extra soot and smoke out of the house. Makes it safer for us. If there is a victim inside, we can see then. It gives them an opportunity to maybe get some fresh air, and hopefully we have a rescue instead of a recovery. Which brings me this to our RIF pack. That was a nice intro. Thank you. That was a nice
intro, wasn't
it? Yeah, great.
We've worked this before.
Yeah. This piece here we just received last month, and this was another thing that kind of led to from the incident with our mutual aid. We've been talking about this for a while and the cost. It's just under $4,000. It's called a rapid intervention pack. I have a downed fireman, I have a rescue victim. I have multiple facets I can use this with this, and the redundancies are perfect and fireman proof, which is great. I got a low pressure with my low ball, because I'm gonna be working in a dark environment. So low pressure, low ball, high T, high pressure, my high pressure. Basically what I have is another air pack set up in a case inside this, just like I'm wearing my back. With the exception of this one, I have an hour's worth of air. It's at a high pressure, 45 PSI. This one here is high pressure at a 45 minute pack. If I have a fireman that has an air emergency within our packs ourselves, if two of us are in, I can hook up a buddy system, pull the cap off, and I can plug into another air pack. If I'm down and I'm trapped and I'm with this guy and I come out and say, hey, John's trapped, I can't get him out.
Like this fireman who fell through the floor.
The rapid intervention team can go in with this device. And like I said, the redundancies are great. NFPA requires a high pressure fill, which I have on the back of my pack. I can pull this cap off, plug this in, and I can hook in, and I will neutralize the hour bottle to my 45, give him 30 minutes, and hopefully we can get him out. And if he's not trapped, I can get him out, and he can walk on his own. It doesn't make a difference what the manufacturer, Rochester uses Scott, Akron, Kiwana use MSA. This is the only national standard fitting. All the other fittings are proprietary to the manufacturers. So I couldn't use my buddy breathing with Akron, but I could use my fill. Everyone has the standard fill. Now if he's in and he's trapped and I'm going to have to take some time to get him out, I can come down here to my low pressure side. Within the pack, I now can hook, I can neutralize. Okay. Now I've got my air pack shut off.
going strictly off of the, it's buzzing to know that I'm on emergency backup, so we're all thinking time. Okay, if he has a problem with his mask because he's been flashed and he's been fired and it's melted and we think his mask is a problem, Scott Air thought of that. And then his regulator is messed up, so I can plug in to my buddy's system, to the regulator, and then I can either, if his mask is good, but he's trapped and he's gonna be a while, I can just swap out the regulators. Now I know I've got an hour, I've got time to work to get my victim out. If it's not trapped or his mask, I got an extra mask. If it's a civilian that's not wearing a mask, I have an extra mask and all the equipment I need. Then, like I said, we normally, you see firemen crawling and dragging. What the clip is here, if he's down and unconscious, I got him breathing, I'm gonna get him out. I feed the strap up and through his strap. And then we grab the harness on the back of the fireman. This is between his legs, and we just drag everyone out, piece them, and it's in close proximity. The hose is long enough to reach. I'm not dragging or distorting any equipment. And we're all out safe and sound, breathing clean, fresh air. Pending your questions.
That will be carried on the fire engine.
This is on engine one. It's the back compartment. It's thrown out anytime someone's going into the structure. This will be at the front door. No ifs, ands, or buts. Or there will be buts.
Mm-hmm. What you're looking at, gentlemen, is a life insurance policy. Any questions for Tom?
No questions. I have a comment. I understand another Rochester fireman went well above the call of duty, or volunteer
yes.
fireman.
This is the third one within a six-month period. Yeah, we had Craig
amazing.
Smith with Daryl Ireland down in Zionsville just before Christmas time, pulled a woman through the sunroof after she went head-on collision with a semi, and as soon as they got her out, that burst into flame. We had Dave Lawson, was our structure fire here in Monticello. Responded to a medical call at 1 o'clock in the morning on a Wyoming, hit a deer, delayed him further. Upon pulling on the road to go home, noticed a large amount of smoke coming out of the eave and the roof line of the house, stopped, woke the tenants up, and saved four lives there. And then Justin Melton and his buddy Joe Johnson, who is from Iowa, actually, he's involved in this switching camo. It's a veterans organization trying to get veterans back in the groove of recreational hunting and doing things like that. Him and Justin had met through that program. Was here actually doing some shopping, getting some hunting stuff as he was heading down to Florida, and they were heading back to the Melton's residence from shopping, and Justin just happened to notice a lot of smoke coming from the back of the Chinese restaurant, pulled in. Actually had a gentleman in the garage trying to suppress the fire with an extinguisher, and Justin said, "It ain't gonna work, get out." And that's when someone alerted him to the two elderly people that were still in the residence, both of them not very mobile at all, in their mid to late 90s. Justin's buddy, a two-time combat veteran, followed Justin in. Of course, street clothes, no breathing apparatus. Fire was just starting to impinge on the back of the house. That's where the residents were. Justin secured the lady. Both of these individuals speak no English, and Justin nor his buddies spoke Mandarin, so it was kind of a snatch and grab. And that's what they did. They got her out, and then they secured him in the ambulance until they were able to take them to a family's residence. So no doubt without that. Justin said smoke was starting to come in. So once again, who would have thought it happened in Rochester so often, but it's, I mean, bravery. I mean, the police deal with it all the time. It's an action of being able to overcome your fears and take action. After the fact, you're probably sitting there and going, okay, it's for the guys. So I appreciate it. I'll pass that along to them, but it's just that ability to overcome your fear and take the appropriate action and move on. Of course, afterwards, then your adrenaline kicks in and you're shaking, but yeah, I'm very proud of all the members of the department, and I'm fortunate to work with a great group of guys. And again, the police department helps out, the EMA helps out, the street department, it's a team effort. So
from one incident to another. The simple thing is bringing barrels up, but that makes a difference for the whole scene and makes everyone safe. I don't have to worry about traffic or a gawker getting hit now and have another incident. So that's one thing to say about Rochester. We do work well together in the minutes of adversity.
Everything was coordinated very well Saturday between our firefighters, the firefighters from outside the community who responded, the sheriff's department, the city police, everything.
EMA was involved. They provided water and food for the guys. EMS, Lutheran, provided blood pressure checks for the guys as they come out and use the bottle. And they were like, oh, no, you're gonna take a rest. Your blood pressure's still a little up. It's one of the biggest killers of firefighters is heart attacks. So they were there monitoring, making sure the guys got ample fluid in and rested. So all around it.
You talk about a disaster plan, Larry. This event Saturday, it was like watching a beehive. It was organized. We did have a little blip with one of the fire hydrants, but
everyone's adapter. The hydrant was, was working. There was an adapter that was supposed to be in our hydrant basket that came out and was underneath the tarp. But I said with the minimum amount that we have for the first truck in. You show up to a structure fire like that and you've got two firemen ready to go. You got one that's going to operate the pump, one that's trying to get an adequate water supply. Dan did open up the monitor, the deck gun, the water cannon, if you will, on the garage, trying to subdue it. We have 1,000 gallons of water on that truck. The truck will pump 1,500 gallons a minute. It doesn't take long to empty our truck with a 3-inch discharge on it. Unfortunately, like I said, there was a little bit of a glitch trying to get that connection hooked up. It was resolved.
But we actually didn't lose a step over it. There was plenty of sources of water.
Other sources coming in, like I said, the rescue truck. There was a 4-minute response from the station to on scene from when it came in. I believe Mr. Mary gave you the run report. I think it was like 12:28. Yep. First engine arrived at 12:32. The rescue truck with more manpower was at 12:36 or something like that. So, and then, you know, more apparatus came. I was out of town. My phone was getting blown up. I was getting as much information as possible, still trying to pass it on to the elected, or to the mayor, so he knew what was going on. But, it all worked out. And until we can afford to have a man station with 20 guys, we're going to have a response where you're going to leave with two or three guys. And then the volunteers, and like I said, I can't say enough about the volunteers. These guys did that for $15. That's what they made that day for leaving whatever they were doing on that Saturday afternoon, going and fighting the fire from 12 to, I don't know, about 4 or 5, I think the time was, and then going back to the station, cleaning all the masks, cleaning the air packs, cleaning the hose, repacking the trucks with the hose, and getting things back in service takes some time, and our guys do that for $15. So I said, I can't say enough, and the paper actually, talks about us quite well, and I'm appreciative of that. But, our volunteers really do the job for us, so.
Well, and it was noted that, we could have used more people. We had over 30 firefighters working that fire in combination with our regular firemen, our volunteers, and people who were coming from outside the community. We had Fire Chief Michael Williams, who was here from Warsaw, making a funeral call at Zimmerman's, saw the activity, grabbed his gear out of his trunk, ran down and fought the fire. Yeah, left his wife at the funeral home.
Yeah, he helped Dan set up.
These firemen they're all about service. They really are, and I'm very proud of Tom and the group. They've now shown me a couple of different times what a quality bunch of folks we have there. I went down to the fire station, and first of all, the first thing that struck me was it's the first time I've seen that station empty of vehicles, everything, all hands were on deck. And then there was a fire in Akron also, so there were a couple things going on.
Akron did leave and pull, and then we had mutual aid with Midtown to help them, so that's the way it kind of works. We leapfrog and jump the assets around, and that's one of the things that when Larry was talking about the NIMS, that's one of the things that I've talked to the boards about that before. I truly encourage you to take that. So in an instance like this, you might be able to, when someone asks you, why are they doing this?
a little bit of the NIMS training, you might understand, well, that's why they're doing that, or how things work out. So,
retired fireman Bob Bailey was there running the radio.
He called the station and didn't get an answer, so he rode his bike up there to, he knows how to work the radio and keep track of the reports in time. So that's what Bob Bailey did. That's the kind of people we have in Rochester. Yeah.
It was all hands on deck.
Yeah, you know what's something going on when Bob comes back. So.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you, Chief. Chief Schatz.
Can you follow that up?
That's a tough act to follow.
That's a fireman.
You want to show him the page or I'll stand up?
Nope, not even going to try.
He volunteered, though.
But Kenny outraces feeding bullet, right?
All right, for the month of February, we had 21 accidents, 78 total warnings, 45 offenses, 22 of those were traffic, 23 were criminal, 30 case reports, 510 calls for service, 31 lockouts, 3 towed vehicles, and 13 people incarcerated. And then you have the list of crimes that people were lodged for by our officers. If you guys have any questions about those numbers, I'd be happy to answer them for you.
Would you like to tell a little bit about the event that led to the arrest and finding of a meth lab at the Rosedale, how that all came about?
Oh, last weekend?
Yeah.
One of our officers made a traffic stop. The vehicle was occupied by four people. One of them had an arrest warrant. Something just didn't add up with the other three, so they started watching them, conducted surveillance. And without divulging all of our secrets, ended up with a search warrant at the Rochester Motel and got a meth lab. So, good job by those guys. Other things, testing is Saturday for our police officers, our potential police officers for our hiring process. Saturday at 9 a.m., they'll show up. We've got a written test followed by the physical agility test. And everyone that turned in an application, I think I've told you guys, gets an invitation to testing. And we had a 15 or 16 applications turned back in. We'll probably have somewhere between 12 and 14 people show up. Typically half are gonna pass the test, maybe a little over. So it's getting cut down real quick. So we'll see how Saturday goes. I'm gonna keep my fingers crossed that they all show up and they all pass the test. Our roofing project, I know we talked about that to the council last year for the roof on City Hall and the police department. That project is moving forward. I'm thinking late spring, early summer before they get to us. Riddle School, I don't know if any of you heard anything about it last Friday. They had an evacuation drill. They evacuated all the students at Riddle to the fairgrounds. So if you've seen a bunch of activity or had questions, that's what that was about. That was last Friday morning. And then striping, we're gonna stripe the, I don't know if you guys have noticed the striping of the parking spaces out front and on the north side of the building, they're getting pretty sparse. So we're gonna have that done at the end of the month or the first of next month. We're actually gonna change the parking on the north side of the building from three spots to pull in where it's gonna be two parallel parking spaces. That way it frees up some room for traffic. I don't know if cars are getting wider or what, but we seem to be getting a lot of complaints there the last few months about our vehicles getting too long and sticking out in the road. And it does. It's a popular intersection, especially for the buses before and after school and Riddle School. So we're going to do what we can to take care of that. That's about all I have, unless you have any questions.
Actually, we have a safety meeting at the Ivy Tech Learning Center every month.
The school safety meeting?
The school safety meeting that Andy and the chief's assistant chief
Murphy
participate in, as well as Lieutenant Campbell and the mayor. We're all there going over safety issues with the school and such, and this issue with our parking and the buses and the terrible time they have coming down through that area led to our changing of the parking area. It also led to some activity we had this morning. Warren and I met with a lady as a result of the safety committee meeting from Duke Energy. and a new city light, street light, is going to go up at the intersection there, just down west of the administration building, at the intersection between Ivy Tech and the administration building. It's an awfully dark area right there. I had not realized how dark that is. Well, we're going to have a new street light put up there with LED lighting. And the 26, we've got 26 lights out throughout the city. Duke's been a little lax in getting those taken care of, and this was another reason we had this meeting. Those are going to be addressed, and we're replacing bulbs with the LED style bulbs as we go on a replacement basis. So we ought to be seeing some reflection in savings pretty soon down the road as a result of that. But that has all come, part of that's come about from the school safety meetings.
Yep. Good. Good to know.
And the chief, also with that meth lab report, I might report that the governor did sign our legislation about the pseudoephedrine. So that is, I don't, you have any idea how long it'll take for that to be law once it's signed, Bob, on the pseudoephedrine?
Well, it becomes a law immediately upon signature, but it takes a little time to implement.
Typically, okay. Most laws that go into effect take effect July 1st.
Okay.
So.
So, that the governor has put his signature on that, so the work that we did here at city and county certainly helped make that happen. So,
and I commend you guys. It was a good job too.
Yeah.
It was a nice push, I would say.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Stand up here if you want.
Anything else? I just like your new shirt. Thanks, Chief. I appreciate that.
That's a Culver shirt.
Next up. Yeah. Like to have Street Supervisor Lenny Connolly give us a short report. Lenny,
let me in.
Sure, come on up.
Hadn't been anything short yet.
Lenny's is going to be short. Yeah.
Well, I'm going to make this short and sweet, or I'm going to have to use Tom's wrist pack over here and see if it really works. But if you guys don't know me, I'm Lenny Connolly. I'm the street foreman. I've been with the street department 27 years, and evidently I like it, or I probably wouldn't have been here that long. But as far as what went on, we're in a transition of moving from the winter activities to the spring thaw, and fixing some yards, and we kind of got into during the winter, and getting the sanders out of the trucks, getting them cleaned up, and in doing that, we found a truck that's got a pretty good sized hole that's developed in the bed, so we're gonna have to look into taking that out to Craig Welding and getting a new floor put in it. But other than that, we're in pretty good shape and all that. We made it through another blizzard. And we've been picking up, been a lot of people trimming limbs and stuff and putting out their debris in the bags. And the bags have been a good program for the city, you know, they, as far as the leaves go, but they're still putting them out in bulk. Been doing some patching and a little bit of sign work. That's about all I have. Do you guys have any questions?
Lenny, I thank you for coming and reporting tonight. You guys are going to see Lenny a little more often. He's a valuable part of the team, and we're going to have more team members appearing to these meetings as we go. And good job in the
winter. You have to excuse me because I don't do good. I never did good with book reports in school or nothing, so talking in front of a crowd, I'm like, I'll try to get better at it, though.
I'm not as good.
Maybe if I get a little bit more experience, like Tom's got underneath his belt, maybe I'll match up. But some one of these days. But that's all I have.
Get an A+.
Thanks,
Lenny.
Hey,
thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
I do have one positive comment that came from some email conversation with a couple of organizations. That the conversation came up about downtown sidewalks, and getting the leaves.
I talked to...
Literally the very next day, you guys were out cleaning them up and getting the sidewalks cleaned up downtown. So two thumbs up to that. And I sent an email back out and said, I think we need to coordinate with the street department when we're talking about this, because it was a coincidence that it happened that way. But
well, that wind, I don't know how it does it, but it seems to circle them leaves around in front of the dugout.
Yes.
And the Hoff's office and the chamber, and we try to keep them cleaned up and an eye on that area, so to keep the downtown looking nice and stuff. So,
well, not and to your credit too, Lenny, a lot of people don't realize you are also the park superintendent.
Yes, sir.
And so you're doing lots of things to get the parks ready right now for the season.
And on that note, we'd ordered one of these swings that the infant sits in, and then the adult sits in, and they could swing at the same time, you know. And the park department decided that was a good idea to put one, you know, in every park that we have, JC's and Fansler's. And I'd just like to say, if anybody wants to try them out, that they're all up now. And if they see anything that needs any modification or revising, so you get with me and I'll make sure it happens.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Warren, I want to hear from Warren. Warren, please.
Well, for those of you who don't know, I'm Warren Lease. I'm the operations manager, City of Rochester. I try to oversee water, wastewater, and street. Try. It's sometimes it's hard to do with. So
don't ask him to ever take any pictures with his smartphone.
Yeah, I am. I am electronically challenged, I guess. Yeah, I took a picture and ended up with a selfie of myself. So believe that or not, and then I couldn't retrieve it. So I'm old school. So
we had some property that had a little issue, and we're looking it over. And I said, get a couple pictures, will you, Warren? And we go to Casey's. He takes a couple pictures. And we go to Casey's. And he's got a selfie.
Yeah. So and
we're gonna get some training with
Yeah, that. And he hasn't got on me for my driving skills either. Let's say I drive about three different cars. I got a truck with a column shift, one with a floor shift. I got another car with a 6-speed on the floor. And we were trying to drive this lady around from Duke Energy to show her the light. And we also showed her another light and where we needed it. And the mayor let me drive because I know where I was going for the other one, out by the condos. And I grabbed the steering, I thought it was a shift column. And really, the shifter was down here. I was grabbing the windshield wiper lever, so I've had kind of a rough 2 weeks here, but I am the certified operator of the wastewater plant. I also am the certified operator of the back flush pond for the water department. And basically we've been since October last year, I've been going back and forth with IDEM. We're getting our new permit July 1st. The big issue with the EPA now is this algae blooms caused by phosphorus. I know you've seen it on the news where, I think it was the city of Cleveland last year, where the algae bloom made the drinking water undrinkable and that kind of stuff. So the deal is they're wanting us to get out of our wastewater. So we're looking at, we've got an engineering firm, Commonwealth. We will be having to remove phosphorus, which is probably about, I think they're figuring $80,000 a year just in chemicals alone. So, and then we also have got an issue with copper and cadmium, which are two metals, which that's also another thing we're going to have to address. But right now I'm in the process of trying to get us a 36-month extension, because if I don't get this done, then when we get a new permit, they're going to expect us to be in compliance right away. It's looking pretty good. I know the lady that writes permits. She's been up before when we had our previous troubles, and it's looking pretty good. We're going to get that done. Like the mayor said, we've been working back and forth. Lenny and I came in early a couple days, found these street lights were all out. I think between the mayor talking, and we had another guy named what Johnston up from Kokomo.
Kevin Johnston.
Yeah, I think
Duke.
With Duke. I think the basic thing was it kind of lost their personal touch. Where when you call in these lights, it goes clear down to Cincinnati. I was telling the mayor how hard it is to get through on them. You got to push the pound button about six times, get somebody the voice, just go through all their menu they got there. You overgo that. But I think maybe they're going to try to get back to having the local guys, you know, get back. I can see a local, one of the local guys just said, hey, we got a light out, get it fixed. So
the thing that I hadn't realized, and I don't think Warren did either, you know, the local people here who work for Duke, they're not allowed to touch any of those kind of things. Mm-hmm. And Duke is so big, they have contracted this service out to other people. Well, sometimes that service slips.
Yeah.
And we now have contacts, and we'll be able to make sure we get some service.
One of the other things, too, we've been doing, we've signed a agreement with Donahue Engineering. We're going to start looking into our stormwater issues. I gave them our sewer atlas for the stormwaters, and they've digitized that. I got it on my computer now, and we can start looking at these trouble areas. We've kind of recognized some of them. They're going to do some hydraulic calculations on the loading onto the system.
Hydraulic modeling.
Yeah, modeling, and try to figure out where we, you know, need to maybe enlarge the system because everything's been added on. So
there'll be some camera work included with this. There'll be some monitoring of as many as 50 different areas for rain flow and how quickly it can be dispersed. And when we're finished, we're going to have a real good plan of attack for going forth and correcting some of these trouble spots that we have been putting up with for years.
Yeah, and you know, it's just something we need to start doing a little bit at a time, and eventually we'll get to the point where we got it done. So I think the other part I'm over is water. I think John's got a report on that maybe later on, but I know we had one issue come up. We had a water softener, we had one of the valves hanging open, and that's something we're going to have to get done. So other than that, that's the way things have been in my world. So unless you got any questions or nothing. Thanks. From John?
Oh, no. Amazing.
You just bring up the magic word, Warren.
Thank you very much, Warren.
Okay. Thanks, Warren. The bobcat? Yeah. Okay. No, yeah, no, I won't bring that up.
Don't bring it up.
Okay. Committee reports. Mark McCall is absent this evening, so we'll move Brian Fedko.
Yeah, Fedko met March 3rd. I was not able to make the meeting. Thank you and Tiffany Terry for providing this report to everyone. So everyone has a report. I'll just hit a couple of things for Channel 4 here. As far as local business goes, everything's pretty steady, a little slower than last year, except unless you're Rapid View, who are in line to post their best quarter ever. The Starbucks out of Kroger is producing better than projected. I want to bring up the small business report. Amy Beachy, the next level business planning class is slated to start April 7th. That's a really good class if you're looking at starting a business, or you know you have one, you know, it can help you get going. She's also planning a customer service workshop for small businesses in September. She's just waiting to hear back from the school for the dates that the room is going to be available. So look for that in September. They're currently talking with EMB out there about extending the road from Blackadder, connecting that area back there to 25. Terry's working on that with the people at EMB. The Dean's Food Building. Officially, the plant is not for sale. I'm not sure why they're hanging on. I mean, I guess they're still moving some equipment and cleaning stuff up. Terry has sent him a couple of referrals of interested parties as well as the Indiana Department of Ag, but that's really something that's not in our hands. We're just waiting on the real estate people. Top Industries is nearing the completion of their expansion, and if the business stays good, they'll be adding another 20 to 30 jobs. And Kevin Birchmeyer is also starting up Top Motorsports in the Olympic Fiberglass facility on 4th Street. And they'll be working with Gertie and maybe machine casting. American Axle, Terry's reached out to them just to kind of, you know, we issued them a tax abatement just to make sure they're doing what they projected, what they said they'd do. And EAS Food Packaging out on Wabash Avenue, the old Delta Tool building. He's doing a lot of work out there improving the facility, and he has hired an engineer, and he's looking at hiring two to three more people. Fedco's been holding up some grant money that he was approved for just to make sure that they were holding up their end of the bargain. And that's pretty much it, unless Terry has something to add.
Questions, comments? Could you elaborate a little bit on Kevin's second venture out there at Tops with the old fiberglass plant?
Yeah, the motorsports?
Yes.
Something that Kevin has loved his whole life, I guess. He's part owner of a team now, and as he's developing the new 100,000 square feet he has out there, he's going to be pulling some operations out of Olympic, the old Olympic building, and moving the motorsports business in there. Gertie is certainly on his radar. I connected him with John Cooley, who does chassis in out of the country, but has expressed some interest in coming to Rochester. So maybe there's a possibility of a partnership there. Something Kevin's pretty excited about, has some good passion about. I'm not sure it's going to be a large job producer or anything like that. But, you know, for instance, he didn't know that there was a machine shop right out his back door for the last 15 years until I was able to introduce him to Monty with machine casting. So just a project that, you know, he's dug into Rochester and Fulton County now. He's investing now for the third time in the past 3 or 4 years. So it's a good company to have growing in our community. So I don't know if that answers your question about motorsports. Yeah. But
sure did.
Small
Thanks,
but
dear.
Growing and filling some space.
Thank you. Okay. Mason, the park board?
All right. We met on the 14th of this month. We started off talking about the pool. Lori Simpson said the sign there needs a little work, and she was soliciting help from Lenny, I think, on that. She said chemicals are ordered, and they are ready to run an ad for the assistant manager position that is open. Then we had Mike, a youth pastor from Faith Outreach, talk to us about a 30-hour famine overnight outreach that they were doing. Asking to use the park May 20 and 21st. We voted to allow them to use that. It's really from, I think, 7 p.m. on the 20th to 11 a.m. on the 21st or so. They'd also be cleaning up whatever they're doing and then cleaning up the park as well and that, so we thought it was a win-win there. Lenny said all the bathrooms are turned on. We're still waiting. The ones by the beach.
Yeah.
AirVac just needed to do something to get those going, but you had all the water turned on. The west pier by the beach needed work, and the foundation has been torn out from the old bathroom, and we need filter for that, and that's at the east side of Manitow Mountain Park. Lyle from the golf course said we're off to a good start due to good weather. We have new goose permits and egg destruction permits to help take care of the goose problem. They'd fixed an outside light in the parking lot, and the parking lot may need sealed and filled. He noticed a lot of cracks that he's worried about creating an issue. Then we talked about the beach again. I mentioned last meeting that there was concern that a permit that we were looking for was only going to be a one-year permit. We were never going to be able to use it again. And that was to blow in pea gravel and kind of clean up the beach area. But the DNR person, Kimberly Landis, had talked to at that point was incorrect, and we can apply every 2 years for that. So that made it worth potentially putting money into it where we'll be able to keep up with it. There's a motion passed to do work at the beach with sand and pea gravel, and we were going over proposals for sidewalk work in the bathroom, and that was tabled.
I might also mention, Mason, that we started out the evening. This meeting was conducted over at the Ivy Tech Learning Center. We moved the location because we installed Emma Feldman in front of the school board, a junior, Rochester High School, as our auxiliary art board member. And then Emma joined us in her first meeting. So that's why we were at the Learning Center. Any questions for Mason? Okay, Terry, anything else to talk about on the Redevelopment Commission?
Yeah, real quick. If you look at the notes I sent out earlier today, if you look at page 5, that'll give you some updates on some of the projects that we're working on. But I wanted to move forward with the request for at least conversation again about establishing an economic revitalization area around the downtown district that enables us to consider property tax abatements on some of the projects that are hopefully we'll be able to move forward with in the downtown area. So that's a process of a declaratory resolution being submitted that defines, the Redevelopment Commission would define the area, which is already defined by either our historic designation zoning or through the slum and blight designation that was passed by the City Council, I think, in 2014. So we already have an area that's defined. Accepting the declaratory resolution would be, okay, we're setting this up for future property tax abatement requests. I have two projects right now with two different developers, if you will, that have requested tax abatement. You don't typically look at tax abatement for retail or service, but the Indiana code does allow for that when economic target revitalization areas are also set up, which the criteria of that means you've either already declared slum and blight or it's in a historic preservation district, which our district is on a National Landmarks Historic Preservation list. So we meet the criteria for that. I expect the timing of it would be that I would get with Andy for the declaratory resolution, to present to you next month probably for consideration. And then it just exists out there, and as we get one project after another or a couple projects as they come in, then the schedule of benefits will be submitted to you guys, which would explain what the project is, and then you decide if tax abatement is allowed on a specific project. But it keeps us from having to do the declaratory resolution and define the area every single time we have a project that comes up. So discussion or thoughts on that, I suppose.
Just seems to save a step each time. And
I think so.
Our decision making is made with the same process, so makes sense.
Okay. Then I'll touch base with Andy and ask him to prepare the declaratory resolution before your next meeting and have that for your review and approval at that time. And then as we get projects, the SB1s will be submitted and you can take those on a case-by-case basis. But it allows us to set up the area for consideration without having to do that for every project. Any questions on, the facade program is moving along. The Times Theater project looks like it's moving along. The 9th and Main looks like it's moving along. Possible interest in the Bailey's building, hopefully moving along. And then Safe Routes to School, we're looking to wrap up a grant from NDOT on that also pretty soon too.
tomorrow at 2 o'clock or something.
Thanks.
Thanks, guys.
Any other questions? All right. Thanks, Terry. Rochester BZA and Council on Aging, Councilman Smith.
BZA meets tomorrow night, so nothing to report there. We, Council on Aging met yesterday, a few things. We did approve two new board members. So Kendra Shadinsky and Brian Holcomb are now on the Council on Aging board. The golf tournament, which is one of the major fundraisers for the Council on Aging, is May 14, 2016 at the Elks. Georgia mentioned, Mayor, that you had a visit down there and
I tried to get lunch, but they'd quit serving.
Well, go earlier next time. And they really appreciated that, but I understand you guys talked about the parking lot situation and the roof situation, and okay. They did have a little conundrum down there, a catch-22, if you will. The fire marshal made an inspection and said, hey, you've got to keep these doors closed. They are an extension of the firewall that's built into the building. And by doing that, then ADA came in and said, you're non-compliant by having those doors closed because they can't move through those doors. So the fire folks came up with a solution. The doors are now open. They're held open by a magnetic thing that was installed in the wall, and if the fire alarm would go off, that clicks the magnetic field off and those doors do close on their own. So the doors are open to keep the building ADA compliant and are fitted for fire suppression if that's the case. Rusty Moore, the director of Transpo, reported that all drivers except one for the Transpo have received a stress and fatigue training. He went to Plymouth and received training with reasonable suspicion for him to be able to observe his drivers. We will be hosting the Northern Indiana NDOT meeting. I don't know what date that is. And then for trips, it's just amazing. For whatever reason, we're really seeing a tick up in 2016. In January, they set a one-day record of trips of 243. They broke that in February with a 246. And it was then broken again in March with a day with 258 trips. The bottom line is last year they averaged 170 trips a day. And so far this year they're averaging 200.3 trips a day. So
per day.
A lot of activity around that building.
That was my thought.
Per day?
Per day.
Yes.
That's a lot of trips.
Yes. It's amazing, staggering. 3,727 trips were made in January alone. So, yeah.
That's good. Now, does that include, like, if they leave the county?
Yes, it does.
The only reason I say that is because I happened to pass a Fulton County Transpo van on my way back into town yesterday from South Bend Airport.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they do that.
You know, with all of that travel, it's phenomenal what the driving record is.
It's phenomenal. They are. We did have an at-fault accident.
I don't know UPS that could beat that. You know, that's pretty good stuff.
They had an at-fault accident, very minor, in 2015, but that's about it for like 3 or 4 years. So
it's great.
Yep. That concludes my report.
Question for you.
Yes, sir.
Is there a
only because I hear it on the radio, they're advertising it. Is there a breakdown in terms of people who pay for it and the ones who are who don't have to pay because of age?
Yes.
Okay. Did you say? Did you mention that or?
I didn't. In the number of trips?
Right, right.
No, I don't know that breakdown for the number.
Okay. I was just curious if there was an uptick in the younger people who need to get there who can't afford it or just overall.
They're actually quite surprised about the amount of activity because of the way that Medicaid reimburses has gone way down. So the Medicaid trips are actually way down, but all those other trips have taken it completely out of the ballpark. So.
Any other questions for Marty? Okay, Chase is not here. I was at the Solid Waste Board meeting. Don't have any figures with me, but the tipping fee situation continues to decline. And it's led to quite a bit of discussion amongst the board. We are scheduling a meeting, Stacy Hart and myself, with the landfill. We're going to go out and review the process for figuring the tipping fees. Also, we met this week with two of the local haulers who have most of the activity for the residential pickup, which most of the tipping fee monies are coming from our residential activity, and they've agreed to provide us on a monthly basis the tonnage that they're hauling, so we can kind of put an unofficial pencil to the activity ourselves and check the folks a bit. So, you know, wasn't it Ronald Reagan who said you trust but verify? So we're getting into a little more of the verification program. I don't have anything from the animal adoption folks, and Chase can.
We had numbers in our packet.
Did you? Okay. Ryan, the tree board and EMS?
Yeah, the tree board met March 4th. The first topic was regarding the revised tree removal agreement as well as the service work orders. Ray Dousman and Shada had worked together with City Attorney Andy Perkins to get all that together, and the board discussed that and approved the newer forms. The next item was regarding the Tree City designation that the Rochester has and the steps that they need to take to continue to have that program. And they agreed to purchase a children's book and a tree guidebook and donate to the library, and also planting a tree near the spillway that where the ash trees have been taken down. And I don't know, this has adding to that, after that meeting, I've noticed that trees have been planted there. I don't know if that had already been something in the works or if that was part of the tree board, but I do know that there are probably 5 or 6 new trees that are planted in there. So. And then the last item was that the Arbor Day recognition or Arbor Day celebration is going to be April 29th. And my understanding was that the mayor was going to do something along with that, so.
We'll do a proclamation.
Yeah, so. Any questions for the tree board question or items? The EMS board met on the 11th day of March in the county building. The main update was that they had received new computers and new radios, and they were still coordinating the differences between all the different agencies in the county and the city, but they're moving forward with all that. They're continuing with training of the members and getting them into the Lutheran system. One of the things which we spoke about earlier regarding the fire in the city was the standby arrangements with the volunteer groups throughout the county and the surrounding areas. And so they were talking about the arrangements for the dual responses and also having an ambulance from Kosciuszko County being available for standby when there were things going on in the city, having a truck here in Rochester, not just being on call. So they are working on that. Lutheran wants to have a new transfer policy, so any transfers from Woodlawn or the nursing homes, that they don't have to farm those out to anybody. They're trying to get all that internal and assume get all the money from that as well. And the last item, which was the Narcan bags, they were donated by Lutheran, and I believe it's going on the fire trucks or the
police? No, the 25, they're trying to get them to law enforcement. Okay. I think they've been talking with Chris Sutters. I'm not sure if they got with you. I kind of mentioned sidebar, they got to get with you immediately as well. But Lutheran purchased 25 Narcan kits, use it for the heroin overdoses. It's an inhalant for first responder can be taught to give this. It's a mister in the nose, and it neutralizes the narcotic effect, clears it up, and a lot of time with the overdose from narcotics, they go into respiratory arrest, so this will go ahead and get them conscious enough when their brain tells them to start breathing again.
I believe the school will even have some of these, and that true, Andy, that come out of our safety meeting, they talked about some of that, yeah.
I thought they were talking about alcohol strips, I knew that.
Yeah, it was actually in the meeting prior to our last meeting, it was mentioned that those Narcan would be available at the school also. So Skeeter, I assume, would be the one using those.
And the last item that they discussed was regarding the helicopter request and standby issues between using Samaritan and Lutheran, and who's going to fight over, who's going to fly somewhere. So, but they're working on getting that taken care of.
Okay.
If there's any questions, that's my report.
Thank you, Brian. John, the water board?
Water board. Thank you. The water board met in regular session on March 14th. Board approved the minutes from the February 1st, 2016 meeting. Delinquent list for the month of March was reviewed and approved. And an update was presented by Shada to the board in the hiring of new office worker. Tina Rowe has been hired. She started on 3/14/16.
Go ahead and stand up, Tina.
Yeah, she was off. She was at the water board. She's been sitting back here keeping an eye on us tonight, guys. So that's what's going on. I've been behaving myself. Okay, Kim Landis asked on behalf of the park board, the Rochester Water Department, supplied a new water pipe for the new restroom at the city park. The water department is not installing the new line, but they are going to give them the piping. Kenny Anderson is discussing running a new water line under Wabash Road. He's going to have to bore it, and they ask if the water department would be willing to help out on the cost. I hope that's just one of the practice ones.
It is.
Yeah, good. Make me feel better already. The water board said we would supply. I thought, gosh, that's going to happen in the middle of mine.
Right, rescue now. Guys, yeah. Rescue guys, get up from under the.
Yeah, they're about to be gone when I'm finishing my report. The water board said we would supply 2 6-inch expansion valves and a 6x6x6 T. Derek presented the board with a couple year old checks, and they're to be credited back to the proper accounts. Backup generators for the water tower sites. If anybody's been by them, I haven't seen the generators set up yet, but I have seen the pads over on the Elks Golf Course one is there, and this has all three generators, automatic transfer switches, and the pads. They'll be installed as soon as possible. The pads are down. I've checked that myself. Update was presented to Barrick on the aviation lights for the Lake Tower and the 4th Street Tower. They've been installed or working. Derek said that the board have replaced the ceiling lights in the old plant, is now the ceiling in the old plant, and also the ceiling lights have been replaced throughout the plant. Walsh Electric did that. An update was presented to the board on the replacement of the outside lights, and they want to put LEDs in because it's just kind of dark out there, even with the lights on. I mean, dim. I thought, you know, it couldn't be that bad for all these years. It was. Let's see, maintenance on well number 2 is now complete. Backforce valves at the old plant, the new valves have now been installed and are working great. They were having a discussion on fluoride and actually a location to put it. And Board, we've talked it over. They will make a decision at the next meeting as to be able to store it in another area. They're crowded right now in the tanks where they have to put it in. My understanding is they use 2 to 3 bags per week, the 50-pound bags, and the Water Board discussed factors getting them like a nice wheelbarrow or something to be able to move them, maybe the 20 feet or something. You have to get them into the tanks to dispose them there. Let's see, Lake Tower, the 4th Street Tower needed inspected either this year or 2017. The board approved to have the towers inspected in 2017. The reasoning behind that was is they were trying to get them all inspected at the same period of time in the same years, having the people come and do them all together in that year.
In sync, yeah.
Yes. Derek presented the board with a quote from Bob's Lock and Key for $4,725.80 to service and replace all the doorknobs, locks, and security plates at the water plant and at the wells, and the board asked for 2 more quotes. Let's see, Terry made the safety on the chlorine issue, which let the board know that they will be installing a red light on the outside of the building so that if there is a leak, didn't realize we had a leak once before, but I guess in the past, Warren, the leak came from,
yeah.
You found out because you opened the door and you walked in.
They had a pretty bad leak by the time they found out when they went in there.
You opened the door and walk in. That's not kosher to safety. So now what they're setting up is on the outside. If something like happens, there will be an automatic switch that will go off a sensor. They'll pick us up and have a signal light outside that will say, okay, guess what? We got a problem inside. And it will be a lot safer for them to go in and then and get, or if they have to call the fire department, to get it fixed. And that about rounds up all the business that was done, and they made a motion to adjourn. Any questions?
Okay. Thank you, John.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Moving on into new business, Kenny Anderson was on our agenda for tonight, and he decided not to attend, that everything he needed to do is pretty much under control. He's, he has purchased a property from Skidmore, south of town, and is going to develop that area into a housing development area. At some point in time, there will be several houses built out there, and we're in the process of working with him on the infrastructure situation that John reported. The water situation we've taken care of, and Warren has worked with him on the sewer situation. And at some point in time, we will have to look seriously at that parcel, in my opinion, for annexation. So anyway, that's what's going on with that. I would like to let you all know of something right now that is in the works. Next meeting, the 26th, I will not be here. You'll have to take the duties, President Dutton. We have an opportunity through the calling process that I talked about when I was campaigning. We've made some contacts, and for the first time ever, Rochester, your mayor, Terry, and Amy Rowe, and Scott Sager. Scott will be helping with the technical aspects. We'll be presenting Rochester to the OrthoWorks group in Warsaw. 3:00 in the afternoon on the 26th. So probably we'll not be able to get back here in time for the meeting. So this is, we're very excited about this. Cheryl Conley, the CEO of OrthoWorks, who's also the president for Zimmer's offshore operations, explained to me that their emphasis, the OrthoWorks group's emphasis for future expansion is into the northern region, the 11 counties that make up the northern region in the economic development scheme, and at some point in time their presence in the orthopedics world will be as far east as Fort Wayne. But it's like I told her, I said, regions are only lines on a map. We're 28 miles south of that in your backyard. She said, that's absolutely true. We can go anywhere we want to. Come on up and present to us. So we have an opportunity, folks. It doesn't mean we're going to be inundated with orthopedics business, but at least they're going to know who we are. So you'll take that helm for me on the 26th, I appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Legal department. We've got transfer of tax sale certificates.
Just brief explanation as to the tax sale certificates. These are problem properties that often have been have a parallel file I opened for an unsafe building complaint at some point in time. And so we began looking at ways to get those over to us, and oftentimes we're kind of left with a Hobson's choice sometimes in those, with either pursuing a sheriff's sale, which has always been kind of problematic, because generally to conduct a sheriff's sale you have to pay all of the taxes, and often these properties are have bad taxes, there are back taxes owed on them. Or when we get property cleaned up, we record those costs, and those are collected as taxes are collected, which drives up the minimum bid at the first tax sale. And so the General Assembly has allowed the commissioners, if at the first sale it's unsuccessful, just for those of you who've never worked with a tax sale, the general way a tax sale works is at the first sale, which happens in the fall, if there is a successful bidder, that person gets a tax sale certificate. They essentially have 9 months to send out appropriate notices, and then they can petition to be issued the deed. They don't receive the property at the tax sale, they receive a certificate. If it's unsuccessful at the first sale, it goes to the commissioners. Commissioners can, but are not required. They can offer it at a commissioner sale. Those usually happen in the spring. And if there is a successful bidder at the commissioner sale, they have a kind of a shortened time frame to send notices and then petition for a deed. Well, what we're allowed to do now is we can say to the commissioners, if it's in the city limits and it's one of these problem properties that we think we may be interested in taking title to, we can shortcut the sheriff sale process, and we don't have to become bidders, but once there is an unsuccessful bidder at the first sheriff sale, they then can assign the certificate to us at no cost. And so what these resolutions do is we don't become owners of the property overnight with all the liability entailments. We just receive the certificate. So once we have the certificate in hand, we can begin the process. When we get these certificates, I'll start the notice process. And if we find some reason between now and then, we don't want to take title to that property, we don't have to. We don't have to petition for title. And we're out the cost of sending some mailings. But I suspect that this will kind of be a new blueprint for problem properties, where you have the dual problem of it's an unsafe building property, but it's also a delinquent tax property. I think this will be a new and hopefully kind of speedier method to go ahead and get those in our useful hands. We can still pursue the unsafe building. We can still find the people who had owned it, and we can still seek injunctions to get on the property if this process still is taking too long. So that doesn't preclude us from taking other action. But you know, I've talked to the mayor and others, and the city's, of course, long-term goal is to take properties where where no one else will step up and do this, to take title to those properties, so long as it doesn't create a liability issue, in the most cost-effective way we can. And this certainly is a useful tool. The commissioners say, hey, if you want this, it's yours. We'll just assign you the tax certificate. And it doesn't cost us anything beyond what we already be doing, and it can actually end up getting us title to the property faster than almost any other method, except a number coming to us and saying, will you take it? So I would recommend the passage of those resolutions, and once those are passed, then the commissioners can assign the tax deed to it, or the certificate to us, and then I will get started with notices, and then probably within 120 days of the assignment, all the notices will have been sent, and I will petition at the end of that time for issuance of tax deeds. And if we find out between now and then, hey, you know, there's something we realize about this property, we don't have to take the deed to it. We don't have to take time.
Which brings the questions of phase one studies and things of that nature to make sure you're not taking charge of a chemical dump or something that's all handled before this process.
These are usually residential properties, and I haven't seen a commercial come through this process yet. That's not something that's required for our petition. It certainly is something, if the city wants to do that, it should get started on those studies as soon as it has an assignment of the certificate, because the clock really starts running on the assignment certificate. And when you're getting this kind of assignment, it's a shortened time frame. It's not 9 months. You need to get those notices out. I think it's in usually in the first 30 days I like to get them out, and then after 90 days you can petition for issuance of the deed. So.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, how about the Lowett Fund Memorandum of Understanding with the county?
I don't know that I have any information on that the council's not already aware of. That had to do with now that I think the long-term plan was, since we entered the Memorandum of Understanding with Lutheran, this is to kind of look back at the prior Lowett agreements, and that's why he had Greg attached those as exhibits, and kind of look forward and say, okay, this is the what the city is entitled to for, I think it's 3 years, I think it commits us for that. This is what the city is going to be expected to pay in to help Fulton County offset those costs.
You all read the MOU? Any questions over that? Okay.
What's the percentage?
Pardon, Tom?
What's the percentage?
30%.
30%. Okay. ADA concerns, none. Let's go right down to the resolutions then. Taking the first resolution, number 04-2016, additional appropriations for park in general. Do I have a motion to read resolution 4-2016?
So moved in its entirety.
Second?
A second.
Moved and seconded. Those in favor? 5-0. Okay, you're on.
Resolution 04-2016, additional appropriation. Whereas it has been determined that it is now necessary to appropriate more money than was appropriated in the annual budget, now therefore, Section 1, be it resolved by the Common Council of the City of Rochester, Fulton County, Indiana, that for the expenses of the taxing unit, the following additional sums of money are hereby appropriated out of the funds named and for the purposes specified, subject to the laws governing the same. Park Operating Fund. Major budget classification, services and charges. Repairs and maintenance golf, $51,500. Repairs and maintenance pool, $8,750. Repairs and maintenance park, $20,600. Total, $80,850. General fund, professional services, $5,000. Legal fees, $5,000, for a total of $10,000.
Now, would you like me to explain?
Please.
The park operating, what happened was, is for years, somehow in our system, with the State Board of Accounts, we have four major budget classifications. And for some reason, the repairs and maintenance cost had been coming out of the classification for supplies. And then the supplies were coming out of the repairs and maintenance. So in my system, in BSNA, I corrected it. Knowing it, I had to correct it on Gateway. Well, when we were going through the budget process, everything, all my documentation had it in there. And when I went back and looked at Gateway, somehow when I flipped it in there, it retained only the amount that was budgeted for supplies. So unfortunately for us, because we had already moved, and when I called the DLGF, when I caught it, we had already done our ordinance, approved it, moved on, and she said, at this point, she goes, we're not concerned about it, just go through an additional appropriation once you receive your budget order. And then we'll have to send it down to DLGF and because the our field representative from the DLGF is the same lady who works with me on our budget, and she, because she could tell the my panicked phone call, she called me back and she's like, relax, it's okay. You know, because she says, you know, things like this happen, and it was just an oversight on my part. I'll take ownership of that. I apparently, when I, like I said, I just didn't triple check it in Gateway. The general fund, that one I'm not 100% certain. That was actually my own line item, which has been the same amount for the last probably 10 or 15 years. And somehow in Gateway, it was zero. And none of us caught it. I mean, there was eight of our eyes on this budget last year. Yeah, like I say, it was just, I think it was one of those things that I may have been making adjustments and hit delete or hit zero and didn't complete it. Again, she said the same thing, just do, actually the general fund, they advised me that I really wouldn't have to do an additional appropriation because our general fund is looked at as an entirety, even though it's departmentalized, but I feel more comfortable in having you guys approve this for that line item as opposed to taking a chance and down the road somebody going, oh, well. So I would rather just take the extra step and do it for DLGF. So that's where we're at with it. And the parks would certainly appreciate having their repair and maintenance budget where it should actually be, as opposed to my error on Gateway when I corrected the other issue. And like I said, and I'm not really sure, I caught it last year, but it was, we were too far into the budget system or into the budget process for me to correct it, or not last year, 2014. So I made plans to correct it for a budget for this year in 2015. And like I said, I apologize. I just overlooked it on Gateway when I looked at it.
In the world of accounting, that's called a correctable incident.
It is. That is correct. Thanks, Ted.
Do I have a motion action on 04-2016?
Move to approve.
Second?
Second.
Those in favor? So moved. Resolution 05-2016. First resolution transfer of tax sale certificates. This is for property at 529 West 6th Street. Do I have a motion for the reading?
Everybody's baseball. I'll make the motion to read in its entirety.
Second by Mason. Those in favor? Okay, five zip.
I'm sorry.
All right. President Goodman.
Resolution number 05-2016, resolution of the City Council of Rochester, Indiana for the transfer of tax sale certificates. Whereas the real property parcel listed in Exhibit A, which is attached here to and made a part of this resolution, was offered for sale at a tax sale conducted by the Fulton County Treasurer on September 11, 2015, pursuant to Indiana Code 6-1.1-24, and whereas an amount was not received equal to or in excess of the minimum sale price for the parcel listed in Exhibit A and pursuant to Indiana Code 6-1.1-24-6, the Board of Commissioners of Fulton County, Indiana, was issued tax sale certificates for the parcel for no consideration. And whereas the City Council of Rochester, Indiana, has determined that it would be in the best interest of Rochester, Indiana, if the tax sale certificate of the parcel listed in Exhibit A was assigned to the City of Rochester, Indiana, pursuant to Indiana Code 6-1.1-24-9 for no consideration. And whereas the Board of Commissioners of Fulton County, Indiana has approved said transfer by resolution, a copy of which is attached and marked Exhibit B, now therefore be it resolved that the City Council of Rochester, Indiana approves acquiring by assignment of the tax sale certificate of the parcel listed in Exhibit A for no consideration to the City of Rochester, Indiana.
Do I, have a motion on action for 05-2016.
Motion to approve it.
Have a motion to approve?
Yeah.
By Mason, a second?
Second.
Second by Brian. Those in favor? 5-0. Resolution 06-2016, transfer tax sale certificates for property at 411 West 11th Street. Do I have the motion?
Make a motion for the reading of Resolution 06-2016 in its entirety.
Second by Mason. Those in favor? 5-0. Okay, sir.
Resolution number 06-2016, the resolution of the City Council of Rochester, Indiana for the transfer of tax sale certificates. Whereas the real property parcel listed in Exhibit A, which is attached hereto and made a part of this resolution, was offered for tax sale at a tax sale conducted by the Fulton County Treasurer on September 11, 2015, pursuant to Indiana Code 6-1.1-24, and whereas an amount was not received equal to or in excess of the minimum sale price for the parcel listed in Exhibit A and pursuant to Indiana Code 6-1.1-24-6, the Board of Commissioners of Fulton County, Indiana was issued tax sale certificates for the parcel for no consideration. And whereas the City Council of Rochester, Indiana has determined that it would be in the best interest of Rochester, Indiana if the tax sale certificate of the parcel listed in Exhibit A was assigned to the City of Rochester, Indiana pursuant to Indiana Code 6-1.1-24-9 for no consideration. And whereas the Board of Commissioners of Fulton County, Indiana has approved said transfer by resolution, a copy of which is attached and marked Exhibit B. Now therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Rochester, Indiana approves acquiring by assignment of the tax sale certificate of the parcel listed in Exhibit A for no consideration to the City of Rochester, Indiana.
Motion for action on Resolution 6-2016.
Motion to approve Resolution 6-2016.
Seconded by Mason. Those in favor, signify. Okay, 5-0.
I'm out of room on my paper. We got to adjourn.
Do what now?
I'm out of room on my paper.
You got a room on your paper? Well, before we adjourn, Cloanne, did you have anything to bring to us tonight? Thank you for coming. Anybody else that... Well, thank you all. I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All of a sudden, nobody's nice.
Everybody wants to talk, right?